Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our webinar on India Budget 2018. Today, we are going to discuss the key changes introduced in the sphere of direct taxation, the major amendments proposed in transfer pricing regime in India, and the major changes in domestic tax law impacting international taxation. The presenters for today are going to be Richa Chawla, partner at GPC in India, Richa Sahani, senior advisor at JPC in India, and Sandeep Sehgal, director at Ashok, Maheshwary and Associates in India. Now I give the floor to the presenters.
Hi, let's begin with the one of the most significant changes that will impact non-residents transacting with India. And this is the introduction of the concept of significant economic presence in our domestic tax laws. Now, over the last couple of years, the government has enacted several provisions in line with the BEPS recommendations. And this change, it seeks to implement the recommendations of Action Plan 1, which relates to the digital economy. If we were to look at the backdrop on in which this change has been introduced, so traditionally, under the tax treaties, business profits of an enterprise are taxed in the host country only if it has a PE there. And the traditional PE rules, they bank heavily on physical nexus or the physical presence in the host country. But since over the years, with the growth of digital economy, there is advent of new businesses and new ways of doing existing businesses. So in those cases, the non-resident can interact and do business in the other country without having physical presence. So the existing PE rules based on physical presence have actually become outdated and redundant. Now, OECD, under the Action Plan 1, it discussed several options to deal with such situation. And the Indian government has already implemented one of them in 2016, which is the introduction of equalization levy. And now the second measure comes, and this is introduction of the concept of significant economic presence. Now, what has been done here is that in the concept of business connection in the domestic law, which is actually akin to the P concept in the treaty, the concept of significant economic presence or SEP has been added, and this concept of business connection has been expanded. Now, this SEP has been defined to mean any transaction in respect of any goods, service or property carried out by a non-resident in India, including provision of download of data or software in India, if the aggregate payment arising from such transaction during the previous year exceeds such amount as may be prescribed. Similarly, systematic and continuous soliciting of business activities or engages in interaction with a number of users as may be prescribed in India through digital means. This has also been covered in the SEP concept. It has been clarified that this will not be impacted by whether or not the agreement for such transaction or such activities was entered in or outside India, whether the non-resident has a place of residence or a place of business in India, and whether the non-resident renders services in India or outside India. These will all be immaterial for the determination of SEP. Now, the net impact would be that under SEP, the download of data or software or soliciting business through digital means would get caught in the tax net. The thresholds, that is the revenue, the number of users, this will be decided subsequently in consultation with stakeholders. It has also been provided that only income attributable to these transactions would be taxable. And the rationale that has been given by the government is that once these domestic law changes have happened, it will enable India to negotiate the treaties for inclusion of this new nexus form in the tax treaties. This change is effective from assessment year 2019 and 20. So then what the position would be like, there'll be two streams of non-residents who will be impacted. First is the non-residents coming from non-treaty countries. They get immediately impacted from assessment year 2019 and 20. The second set of non-residents who come through a treaty country, they continue to get the benefit till the treaty is amended to incorporate this concept.
The next slide. Yeah. Next slide, please. Next slide talks about
Richa,
the rationalization.
Just a quick question. As you just say that it has to be negotiated in the treaty with the treaty partner. Now, having these type of measures, we know that a digital economy is itself throw challenges on permanent establishment, and this is more like a very, very direct method to tax their activities. So don't you think that there will be resistance from other treaty partners to agree on such changes?
The government is expecting, currently this is not part of the multilateral instrument, but since it's part of the BEPS recommendation, they are expecting that the other countries who've been party to these discussions will, in a short while, you know, or maybe in a couple of years, they will also incorporate these kind of changes, and they will be receptive to incorporating these changes in the treaties. But then we have to wait and watch on which country and, you know, what time these changes happen. But as far as the non-treaty country goes, this becomes immediately applicable from assessment year 2019 and 20.
And I think we can already see what is happening in Europe. Like there's already a proposal on levying taxes on the digital company. That's already happening now in proposal.
Yeah, in fact, India has been a front runner in the BEPS implementation part. So was the first country to introduce equalization levy. So we've already introduced a lot of changes based on the BEPS recommendation. So this is one of those changes, you know, because the Indian government is very aggressively trying to get these into the domestic law as well.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, the next slide talks about the rationalization of provision relating to country by country reporting in India, which has been applicable in India in financial year 16-17. The Section 286 of the Income Tax Act has been introduced last year. I will just take you through the, you know, brief outline of this section, which is the changes based on Action Plan 13 of BEPS of OECD. So here, basically, we need to see that there are three entities who are required to do the CBCR reporting in India, whether it is a parent entity, if it is resident in India, or the alternative reporting entity, which has been designated by the group to do the reporting, or it can be the constituent entity, entity resident in India, subject to certain conditions. So the condition for CBCR is that consolidated international group revenues should exceed INR 55,000 million, which is $843 million, in the accounting year preceding the reporting accounting year. So this is important change, accounting year preceding the reporting accounting year. So next you can go through the table. The first row shows that every CE resident in India of an international group whose parent is non-resident, it has to file, it talks every CE resident in India, it has to file Form 3CESC by 31st January following the relevant fiscal year. In the form, it has to state the details of the parent entity or the alternate reporting entity, as the case may be, who is doing the filing outside India. It is just an intimation to the tax authorities. The next is the parent entity or the alternate reporting entity which is resident in India. It is Form 3CEAD, which is a full-end filing form which is to be submitted for CBCR compliance in India. The due date has been amended. Earlier, it was to be filed before the due date of return of income, that was November 30th, following the relevant fiscal year, but now it has been extended to 12 months from the end of the reporting accounting year, which will now be 31st March, following the relevant fiscal year. The third is the constituent entity resident in India is required to file CBCR subject to certain conditions, like suppose there is no exchange agreement or there is a systematic failure. There are a few conditions prescribed in this section. The form is again 3CEAD as discussed above, and time period is same 12 months, that is March 31st. In case there are more than one CE resident in India, the international group may opt to designate a CE who will file the form 3CEAD of CBCR, but the intimation of the designated CE, a designated entity, need to be filed by the designated CE in form 3CEAE. For filing 3CEAE, the due date of filing form has not been prescribed yet. So basically, the amendment, as we have discussed above, the time allowed for furnishing the CBCR in all the cases like parent entity, alternate reporting entity or CE has been extended to 12 months from the end of the reporting accounting year as against the due date of return of income. The second is, like, if the parent entity outside India has no obligation to file the report in its own country, then the constituent entity in India is required to file the CBCR in its where it is resident. Like in India, if it is the constituent entity is in India, it has to file the CBCR. If the parent entity outside India has no obligation to file the report. The second is, if the second amendment has been brought, that alternate reporting entity of the group, if it files the CBCR in its home country according to its own timeline, then it is sufficient for Indian entity to not to file the CbCR. So current situation is that CE residents in India are required to file only a notification and not the report in India, provided there exists either an agreement such as DTAA or a notified agreement for exchange of CbCR. So as of now, earlier it was a situation odd, like either an agreement should exist or a notified agreement for exchange of CbCR. But now the definition of agreement has been amended to include combination of both an agreement and an agreement for exchange of CbCR. If both these conditions are satisfied, then only the constituent entity resident in India is not required to file the report. Reporting accounting year is amended to mean accounting year in respect of which the financial and operational results are required to be reflected in CbCR filed. Next slide, we are talking about the corporate tax rates. To boost the small and medium-sized domestic companies in India, the budget has amended to reduce the tax rate to 25% with a condition that the annual turnover or gross receipt does not exceed 2,500 million. In financial year 16-17. But the companies other than above and LLP and firms will continue to be taxed at the rate of 30%. The next amendment is like health and education cess of 4% has been introduced, replacing existing education cess of 2% and secondary higher education of cess of 1%. There is a 1% increase in the cess to boost the poor families in India. This is applicable from assessment year 19-20.
We may just point out that in his budget speech for 2015 and 16, the finance minister had indicated that the government intends to reduce the corporate tax rate to 25% over the next 4 years. And this is in line with his statement given at that point of time. And this exemption, it's broad enough to cover 99% of the tax-paying companies in India. Please note, however, that the LLPs and the partnership firms, they continue to be governed by the rate of 30%.
Next slide.
But then, Richa, how much would be the effective, like how much would be the tax rate if you add up other levies on it? Like 25% is the tax rate, but then there are others like health and education, cess is being replacing, existing education cess, and there would be some more add-ons to it. So how much would be the total tax rate for...
The cess and the surcharge also, the surcharge actually depends on the quantum of the income also. But we could say approximately 28.6% would be the generic case, with of course a little bit of variation depending upon which slab you actually fall into.
And for other companies not covered by this, they will have maybe between 33.5-34, right?
Yes. The minimum alternate tax rates, however, continue to be the older ones, so with not much impact on the match-paying companies.
Okay, thank you.
So the next slide talks about the PAN mandatory in certain cases. As per the budget 2018, the non-individual entity will have to obtain a PAN as its unique entity number. Subject to the condition, if it enters into a financial transaction of an amount aggregating to INR 2.25 million or more in a financial year. So basically, if an entity enters into a transaction aggregating to 2.25 million or more in a financial year, it is mandatory to have a PAN in India. The scope of financial transaction has not been clarified yet by the tax authorities. It is still awaited. The scope of this provision is restricted to non-individual resident person, but point is to be noted here is that the managing director or the authorized signatory of the person who will sign the return is mandatory required to have the PAN in India. So this amendment is applicable from assessment year 18-19. Next slide. Tax neutral transfers. Earlier, under Section 47 of Capital Gain Tax, any transfer of capital asset by a company to its holding company to its subsidiary or subsidiary company to its holding company was not taxed under head capital gain, but it could be taxed under Section 56, which is other sources of the Income Tax Act, if the transfer was done for no consideration or for inadequate consideration. But now the amendment has been brought in the Section 56 of the Income Tax Act. Any transfer of capital asset by holding to subsidiary or vice versa would be excluded from Section 56 of the Income Tax Act, and it would be applicable for the transaction made on or after 1st April 2018.
What needs to be noted here is that this benefit is available only when the recipient of the property is an Indian company. That is, when a transfer happens from a parent to a subsidiary, the subsidiary needs to be an Indian company. When the transfer happens from the subsidiary to the parent needs to be an Indian entity.
So the objective, the stated government objective for this is to help in the internal structuring within the group. The taxability of compensation in connection to business or employment. As per the existing provision, Section 28 of the Income Tax Act, which talks about subclause 2nd of the Section 28, it talks about specified compensations which are taxable under the profit and gains of business or profession of the Act. But as of now, any compensation received or receivable, whether revenue or capital in connection to the termination or the modification of the terms and condition of any contract relating to its business, was not included. So now it has been included, where the company receives any compensation received, whether revenue or capital in nature on account of termination or modification in the terms and conditions of any contract, that would be taxable under Section 28 of the Income Tax Act. And similar amendment has been made in Section 56, other sources of the Income Tax Act. If the employee receives any compensation in connection with the termination or the modification of the terms and conditions of any contract relating to his employment, it shall be taxable under Section 56 of the Income Tax Act. It is applicable from assessment year 1920. One point is to be noted here. In the first bullet, it talks about contract relating to its business. Here, professions are not covered yet. So this is a new scheme for scrutiny assessment which has been introduced in India from 1st April 2018. The aim is basically to eliminate the interface between the assessing officer and the assessee, and also to improve greater transparency, accountability, and eliminate corruption. It would be an email-based communication for paperless scrutiny proceedings. Here, tax officers and the assessee won't meet, and it would be done all through electronic proceedings. It is team-based assessment with dynamic jurisdiction.
The CBDT chairman has, in the recent discussions, pointed out that assessment or any assessment for entity would henceforth be handled by two officers instead of one. And taking this initiative further, a centralized communication scheme for 2018 has already been notified.
So, major to promote startups, Section 80IAC, certain amendments have been brought in this section of 80IAC with existing provision and new provision in the tabular format you can see. First criteria is the date of incorporation. The sunset provision, like companies incorporated on or after 1st April 16 and before 1st April 2019 were earlier categorized as startups, but now it has been extended till 1st April 2021. If the company is incorporated on or after April 16, before April 1, 2021, it is categorized as startup. Second criteria is the turnover in which the amendment has been made. Earlier, as per the existing provision, a company whose turnover does not exceed INR 250 million, that is 3.83 US dollar million in any previous year, beginning on or after 1st April 16 and ending on 31st March 2021, was categorized as startup. But now the criteria of turnover not exceeding 250 million to be clear in which the deduction is being claimed by the company. The next amendment has been brought in the definition of eligible business, which has been expanded. As per the existing provision, business which involves innovation, development, deployment, or commercialization of new products, processes, or services driven by technology or intellectual property, which has now been expanded. Now it says business engaged in innovation, development, or improvement of products, processes or services, or a scalable business model with a high potential of employment generation or wealth creation. The word new has been dropped and no definition of scalable business model has been provided as of now. It is effective from assessment year 1819. Next is the rationalization of Section 276CC relating to prosecution for failure to furnish returns. As of now, the currently willful failure to furnish the return of income by the due date was punishable with the imprisonment and the fine under this section. Now, and the condition was that no proceedings if the tax payable on the total income determined on regular assessment as reduced by advance tax and TDS does not exceed 0.003 million. So now it has been like if the tax payable even does not exceed 3,000 and the company is filing the nil return claiming DTAA relief, the prosecution can be done. It is an anti-abuse measure benefit of the carve-out withdrawn for companies. It is applicable from 1st April 2018.
So the first provision is that the definition of business connection under Section 9 of the Indian Income Tax has been broadened. So as we know that under the multilateral instrument, the contracts, where, I mean, especially for arrangements like commissionaire arrangement, where some companies used to resort to hire agents in India, and these agents were doing a lot of other activities, but they were not actually doing the final stage of concluding the contract. So they were not considered that they are permanent establishment of the entity for which they are working in India. So the multilateral instrument under BEST provision, as we know, it has incorporated the provision that where the activities are such that where the agent is not doing the final conclusion, but he is involved in a lot of other activities, leads to conclusion of the activities, those activities will always be considered permanent establishment in India. But the business connection definition under Section 9 actually contained only the provision that activities leading to conclusion or habitually leading to conclusion would be considered as business connection in India. Now it has been broadened to keep it in line with the multilateral instrument so that both the definitions are in sync. Otherwise, what would can we move to next slide where I have elaborated this thing? So like I have mentioned that the SSE still have the option to pick and choose between the domestic act and the provisions of DTAA, which are beneficial to the SSE. So even if the multilateral instrument would have said that that this arrangement would amount to PE in India, but if the domestic act doesn't say that, so the taxpayers have the option to avail the domestic provisions and then can get out of this. So that's why it is essential that the what has been proposed in the multilateral instrument and what is written in the domestic law should be in sync. So now this provision has been incorporated and the definition of business connection has been broadened and it has been kept in sync with that. Can we move to next slide? So like I said, with the inclusion of word or habitually play the principal role leading to conclusion of the contract by that non-resident. So it means that that even if the activity, even if the agent is not doing, I would say not especially concluding the contracts, but his activities are such that it can be seen that he is actually involved in a lot of the activities which are leading to conclusion. So those activities would come under the provision of permanent establishment or business connection. And this amendment would be applicable from assessment year 1920 onwards. So under the provisions of section 2, subsection 22 and clause E of the Income Tax Act, there is a provision that if a company pays loans and advances to its shareholders, it can be considered as deemed dividend if the company has accumulated profits in its balance sheet. So it is actually to plug the loophole that there could be an arrangement that the company is not paying dividend to its shareholders and avoiding distribution tax and tax on the hands of the shareholders. So to circumvent that, they can pay loans and advances and they have liberty to pay them at whatever time that suits them. So to plug that, it has been provided that such a thing, if the company has accumulated profits, that would amount to payment of dividend and the that amount would be taxable in the hands of the shareholders. So now what has been done is this provision is actually been simplified and it says that instead of that amount being taxable in the hands of the shareholders, the company would be supposed to pay dividend distribution tax on those amounts. So the impact could be that earlier when the amount was taxable in the hand of shareholders, they could have losses in the income tax return, which could be set off under that amount. Now that thing is gone. So the company pays the tax and since this amount is already exempt, they would not be able to utilize that loss amount. So obviously the government gets more revenue out of this provision. And the other thing is, this provision is applicable from assessment year 1920 onwards. So yeah, it says that the next provision is that it has widened the definition of accumulated profits. So it is related to earlier provision. So if you talk about that the loan to the extent of accumulated profit would be taxable in the hands of shareholders or the company would be liable to pay DDT, what is the definition of accumulated profits? So it basically means whatever profits which are appearing in the balance sheet of the company. So now what has happened, there's again a loophole that where a company which has accumulated profits in its balance sheet and it gets merged or amalgamated into another company. So the profits of the company which is amalgamating, that could be they could be capitalized or not, but the new company has the option to pay the amount of advances to the shareholders. So to circumvent that, it has been provided that the profit standing in the books of the amalgamated company would also be considered for calculating these accumulated profits of the amalgamated company. So it says the new regime for taxation of long-term capital gains on sale of equity shares. So as we know that the sale of the long-term capital gain on sale of listed equity shares and equity-oriented mutual funds used to be exempt in the hands of the taxpayers. But with effect from assessment in 1920, this exemption has been removed. However, they have kept the tax rate at 10% only. So the implication being that if you sell the listed equity shares and listed or equity-oriented mutual funds on or after 1st April 2018, any long-term capital gain on those equity shares and mutual funds would be taxable at the rate of 10%. However, no indexation would be allowed on the cost, and also no effect of foreign exchange rate would also be allowed under this provision. Also, the gains up to 1 lakh rupees annually would still be exempt in the hands of the taxpayers. So those would not be taxed. Besides, since the budget was presented on 1st Feb, they have introduced that up to 31st January, that what would be the cost of these shares. They said that the value on the stock exchange as on 31st January would be considered cost of these shares or the actual cost to the taxpayer, whichever is higher. So let's say if you have as on 31st January 2018, the share price is 250. So the intention is the gain that you have earned till 31st January, they would not tax this amount. So, and let's say if you sell this share in May 2018, for let's say 350 rupees. So this 100 rupees only would be taxed under this provision. Subject to obviously that you don't have, that your gain exceed 1 lakh annually for this particular year. Also, one more thing. When this provision came under the finance bill, they didn't consider what would happen when the taxpayer purchase the shares, those were unlisted, but when the shares are being sold, the shares while passing this budget in the Lok Sabha, they have introduced the provision that in such cases where the taxpayer purchased the shares and at that time the shares were unlisted, so what would happen is that you have allowed indexation up to financial year 17-18. So that is if you have purchased the shares in, let's say, April 2015. So you can index those shares up to financial year 17-18, and thereafter that would be considered your cost whenever you sell those shares. And this amendment is effective from assessment year 1920. And also this grandfathering provision also applies to in the case of mergers. So let's say when you purchase the shares of an unlisted company and it gets merged into a listed entity, so what would be the cost of those shares? So they said that you can index the cost up to financial year 17-18, and that would be considered your cost for those particular shares. It's a dividend distribution tax on dividend payouts to unit holders in equity-oriented firm. Erstwhile, the companies obviously are subject to pay dividend distribution tax while distributing dividends to their shareholders. But there is no such provision in case of mutual funds. So when the mutual funds used to pay dividend to the unit holders, they were not required to pay any duty. Now it has been introduced. And this amendment will be effective from assessment year 1920. So the impact I see is that it could that now people may prefer to move to growth funds, because obviously growth funds generally don't pay dividend. So obviously the amount can get accumulated, and there is no, I mean, you don't lose any chunk of money if you have received dividend for those particular growth. So obviously, if you have, so now since LTCG has been introduced for equity-oriented mutual funds, you will now be subject to pay LTCG on those units. So it says taxation of long-term capital gains in the case of foreign institutional investors. So, I mean, so what is like in the early provision where we see that the equity shares and long and equity mutual funds, the long-term capital gain has been taxed. The same position is for FIIs as well. And the exemption up to 1 lakh annually has been introduced for them as well. And it is also applicable from assessment year 1920. So it says exemption of income of foreign company from sale of leftover stock of crude oil on termination of agreement. So the provision says that under section 10 clause 48A, there is a provision that if a foreign company is doing exploration of oil, or sorry, storage of crude oil in India, the business income for that particular activity is exempt in India for that foreign company. So then the last year in financial year 2017, say clause 48B was introduced, which said that let's say the agreement period gets over and they have some leftover stock which they sell. So they say that even the sale of that leftover stock would also not be taxed. However, that what has been amended in this year is they say that the earlier provision said that if the agreement period gets over, but now it is even if the agreement is terminated for any particular reason under the terms of that particular agreement with the central government, then in that case, that amount would also be exempt. What happens is that, so obviously the companies in India, if they have booked profits in their as per their accounts, but under the income tax computation, they have a loss. So 18.5% amount of tax, which is called MAT, on book profits is levied on those companies, which is allowed credit afterwards for 15 years. So for the calculation of that book profit under this provision, the companies are allowed to set off the lower of unabsorbed depreciation and brought forward losses. Okay, but the companies who are going into liquidation under this new insolvency and bankruptcy code, they have been provided the relief that they don't need to follow this provision of lower of unabsorbed depreciation and brought forward losses, and they can set off both amounts for the calculation of their book profits. Okay. And also one more relief has been introduced, that this provision would not be applicable on those foreign companies who are doing certain activities in India, like under section 44B, shipping business, mineral oil exploration, operation of aircraft or civil construction. So, and these companies have been given this exemption from with retrospective effect from assessment year 2001 and 2 onwards. And also there is one more point related I forgot to include in this slide. There is section 79 under the Income Tax Act, which says that if a company has some brought forward losses under the provisions of Income Tax Act, it can carry forward to the next particular year. However, if the shareholding of the company gets changed for more than 50%, that is effectually the owners of the company gets changed, those companies would not be allowed to carry forward their losses. So for the companies who are going liquidation under this insolvency and bankruptcy code, they have been provided the relief that obviously their shareholding would change if any other company buys that company, any other person buys that company. So they have been given the relief that they can carry forward their losses, but other companies are not allowed to do it. So it says amendments in relation to notified income computation and disclosure standard, that is ICDS. So with effect from finance at 2017, the income tax department introduced certain ICDS standards. We said that if you are calculating income under the income tax provisions, so then you need to follow these standards to arrive at your profits. So for something, for some particular issues, there were disparity in the provisions of the ICDS and the already settled position under the domestic law. So an attempt for due to which there were some litigations as well, where some high courts have actually struck down some of the ICDS provision. So here the government has intended to keep the income tax provisions in the ICDS provisions in sync. So the first provision is section 36. And what has been done is ICDS 8 allows mark-to-market loss for the securities held in the books of the company, which are obviously held for trading purposes. So it says that section 36 has been amended, and it says that if the profit or loss has been calculated as per the provisions of ICDS 8, that mark-to-market loss would be allowed as deduction under section 36 for the computation of taxable income of the taxpayer. The other provision is section 40 capital A lists certain items where it expressly said that these kind of expenses would not be allowed as deduction while calculating the taxable income of a taxpayer. For example, cash payments above a particular limit, like 20,000, under section 40A, subsection 3. So now it says that any kind of mark-to-market losses would not be allowed. However, if the loss is calculated under section 36, that is under the provisions of ICDS 8, that loss would be allowed. See, the other provision is section 43AA, which is a new provision which has been inserted. It says that under the earlier provisions, the forex gain loss for particularly capital assets under the income tax provisions were allowed to be adjusted from the cost of that particular asset, but there were no such provisions for other assets of the company, like current assets, like debtors, creditors, and everything. Now this provision has been introduced, which says that if the loss has been calculated under the provisions of as per the methods prescribed in ICDS 6, then the forex gain loss on these particular items would be allowed under the Income Tax Act. Similarly, the ICDS 3 states that the profits for construction profit should be calculated as per percentage completion method. And the position was more or less the same was under income tax provision, because there were many judicial rulings to support this argument. Now this position has expressly been included, and a new section 43CB has been introduced, which says that yes, this percentage completion method would be adopted for construction contracts. And the last provision is section 145 capital A, which says that which actually follows the ICDS 2 provision, which says that for valuation of inventory, the cost of market price, whichever is lower, it shall be considered the cost of the stock. However, the earlier provision under 145 capital A allowed the SSC to use any method, but it should be consistent from year to year. So the impact would be, now you are allowed to follow on this particular method only, that it should be either cost or market price or net realizable value, whichever is lower. So these provisions are applicable with effect from assessment year 1819 onwards.
Thank you so much to our presenters for sharing their knowledge and expertise with us. And also thank you to all attendees for joining us today.